Come to order, please. Good morning. Welcome to Commissioner St. Mary's County meeting this date, Tuesday, June 28, 2016. I am Randy Guy, President of Commissioner St. Mary's County. I'd like to introduce the other four commissioners seated next to me. Seated to my right, representing First Commissioner District, which includes Ridge, Piney Point, and St. George's Island, Mr. Tom Jarboe.
Good morning.
Representing the Second Commissioner District, which includes Leonardtown and Hollywood, Mr. Mike Hewitt.
Good morning.
Seated to my immediate left, representing the Third Commissioner District, which includes Charlotte Hall, 7th District, and Golden Beach, Mr. John O'Connor.
Good morning.
And seated next to him, representing the Fourth Commissioner District, which includes Lexington Park, Summit, California, Great Milton, Todd Morgan. Seated next to Commissioner Morgan, at the end of the table, there's Dr. Rebecca Bridget, County Administrator.
Good morning.
Excuse me, Dr. Bridget. On my immediate right is Sharon Ferris, our recorder. And behind the glass, which many of you don't see, is Ms. Amy Carter. She's our video media producer. So please look good and smile when you come to the front. Please turn your cell phones off or on vibrate. When you come to the presenter's table, please approach coming down the center aisle. And remember, this meeting is being televised, so you need to speak clearly and directly into the microphone for recording purposes. At this time, we have the invocation and pledge by Commissioner Hewitt. Please stand.
This morning, Fulton Letourneau is going to give the invocation.
Bow our heads. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you so very much for this precious day you've given us. We come before the throne again today, not because we are worthy, but because what you did for us 2,000 years ago on a cross called Calvary. We ask you, Lord, to bless our servicemen. Bless our county sheriff's department and all the deputies. Bless all our county commissioners and our officers and department heads. Bless all of our county members and give us wisdom to do the right things for our citizens. In Jesus' name we pray.
Amen. Please join me in the pledge.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you, Mr. Hewitt. This time we entertain the approval of the last meeting minutes.
I move to approve the minutes of June 21st, 2016 as presented.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
So moved. Okay, we have several proclamations today. We have to put out the 70th anniversary of Lexington Park Lions Club. So I'd like to have those please come forward. I think to Mr. Sal Raspa, Tom McCarthy, and anyone else involved with the Lions Club, please come forward.
All right. Yeah, come on up front, fellas.
One time, sir.
Good morning.
But hey, how you doing?
Good.
How you been?
Good. Okay, whereas on January 29th, 1946, the Lexington Park Lions Club was chartered. And whereas the Lexington Park Lions Club provides vision screening for preschool children, offers financial assistance for eye and hearing exams, eyeglasses and hearing aids, and awards an annual scholarship to two graduating seniors at Great Mills High School, coordinates American Red Cross blood drives, and sponsors local families at Christmas. And whereas Lexington Park Lions Club supports Lions Club district programs such as Lions Club 22C Youth Band in Camp Merrick and Camp Nanjamoy, Maryland, which provides recreational activities for diabetic children. The organization also supports international programs such as Sight First 1 and 2, which strives to rid the world of preventable and reversible blindness. And whereas Lexington Park Lions Club has many members who participate in other volunteer activities such as Meals on Wheels, AARP Tax Aid, United Way Day of Caring, boating safety training, and a variety of other activities. Now, therefore, we, the commissioners of St. Mary's County, do hereby congratulate Lexington Park Lions Club on the occasion of their 70th anniversary and recognize the ongoing care and commitment its members have provided the people of St. Mary's County since 1946, this day, June 28, 2016.
Thank Okay, Sal, if you have anything to say, please speak up. I know you got something to say.
You have to talk. You have to talk.
Yes, sir.
Thank you. Tell us about the Lions Club.
The greatest organization that one could belong to, in my opinion. The Lions International is the largest service organization in the world. We service our community, as you all know. There are 5 Lions clubs in St. Mary's County, and we all do approximately the same kinds of things. Each club has its own list of programs to help children, people, and it's not just glasses anymore. Originally, the Lions was to help the blind, and we had the Lead a Dog program, and there were several people in St. Mary's County that the Lions clubs of our county had contributed funds for the Lead a Dog program, and there's several people that had that were involved in that program in past years. In any event, I want to ask all of you to come visit the Lions clubs in whatever area you live in the county, either be Mechanicsville, Leonardtown, Lexington Park, Hollywood, Ridge, and take part in what the Lions are trying to do. We can't do it all ourselves. We need your help. It's all volunteer work, and we have a great time helping people. Thank you very, very much for this recognition. And we appreciate it very, very much. Thank you, sir.
Very good.
It is very worthy. I'm a member of the Leonardtown Lions Club, and we also sponsor a unit up at the Wilmer Eye Institute, which helps those who have, say, an optic nerve attack or whatever to better lines of vision. And we actually sponsor that entire unit up at Wilmer Eye Institute. And I'm a beneficiary of 5 years ago getting partial cornea transplants in both eyes, going from near blindness to good vision. Tell you the truth, I can't see it, but a little bit of distance vision. But the Lions Clubs have our own vans and everything for testing your vision and testing your hearing. We go to the schools and everything else, and it's a great organization for funding, especially the eye research. Anybody get up front here, please,
and have a front. We'll have a picture.
Next, we got a proclamation for Dr. Roach, his retirement. Many of you know this man very well already. Not much we can say about him, except he's been a great part of the community for many, many years. And you're going to continue, right, Dr. Roach?
Yes.
For anybody that's lived in St. Mary's County for any amount of time, you've had to have crossed paths with this man, and it had to have been a good experience. I gotta say, when I first got elected, he asked us to come over and listen to something about ALS. It was all good. But boy, did we get a little bit of chewing, me and Randy. ALS is a great thing, and they're gonna get our support. So, with that said, whereas, during his long and distinguished career, Dr. John William Roach Jr. has touched the lives of countless patients, and many of whom include multiple generations among family, friends, neighbors, and coworkers. For over 42 years at MedStar St. Mary's Hospital, he has been an outstanding example of care and commitment in his field, and has risen through the senior medical staff ranking as chief of staff and chief of surgery. And whereas Dr. John William Roach Jr.'s dedication to the county is shown through the many committees and boards he has sat on through the years,
Among them are the Hospital Cancer Committee, Tissue and Transfusion Committee, Infectious Control, Hospital Disaster, Medical Society, St. Mary's Riken High School Alumni Board Member, Leonard Hall Junior Naval Academy Board of Trustees, Board to the Juvenile Drug Program in St. Mary's County, Board of Trustees to the College of Southern Maryland, and is currently the three-term president of the Board of Directors for the St. Mary's County Historical Society. And whereas Dr. John William Roach Jr. has been a devoted member of Mechanicsville Volunteer Rescue Squad for 56 years, serving 36 years as president and 2 years as vice president. He also served as president of the St. Mary's County Rescue Association for 26 years. In 2003, he was inducted into the Southern Maryland Volunteer Firemen Association Hall of Fame and has received the Maryland Institute for Emergency Medical Services Southern Maryland Star of Life and Leon W. Hayes Award for Excellence. And whereas, in his spare time, if he hasn't, Dr. John William Roach Jr. is an avid duck hunter and enjoys cutting grass. He has merited the love and respect of countless friends, family, patients, and co-workers during his long career, and is considered a true leader in the county. Through his diligence, dedication, and relentless pursuit of excellence, he has rightfully earned the community's sincere gratitude, respect, and admiration. Now, therefore, we, the commissioners of St. Mary's County, do hereby express our appreciation to Dr. John William Roach, Jr., for his many years of service to St. Mary's County and its citizens. We extend sincere congratulations to him on this occasion of his retirement and best wishes for many more years of happiness and ask God's blessing upon him. This date, June 28, 2016.
Thank you so very, very much. What does one say? Having been born, raised, and grown up in St. Mary's County, and just like Mike says, St. Mary's County, it's our old county heritage, and our oats and the boats and the hosts and the hogs and dogs, deep by gods and crypts and skillets.
That's the way it is.
And be proud of it. Because when you think about this nation started with 13 original colonies, and one of those 13 colonies is 10 miles, 15 miles down the road. And too many people have no regard for that, no regard for who we are, what we are, and where we came from. And they tend to make fun of us. And that's wrong, because we are special. Most influential person in my life was probably my father. Unfortunately, I didn't have a lot of life with him. He died when I was still away in training. But the one thing he preached all the time was you can't just take, you've got to give back. And when you give back, you begin to reap how much it means to you. And this is a very, very special place. It's a very special community, very special county. The people are very special. And of all the things that I shall miss when I hang up the shingle are the people, the telling the stories, the kidding, and the joking. Those are the things that are special. And when we don't have time to do that, and we don't have time to respect our heritage, and who we are and what we are, it's a sad day. But anyway, I want to thank you very, very much for this honor. It's very special. I don't know who's running the hospital this morning, but I worry about that. But at any rate, thank you, thank you, thank you.
Thank you, Dr. 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 Thank you, Dr.
Faith?
Faith.
Okay, next we have a presentation for the 6th Annual Employee Safety Matters Awards for 2016. Patty, I'm going to turn it over to you.
Good morning, Commissioners. I'm Patty Stigman, Chairperson of the Employee Safety Committee, and with me is Kyle Keebaugh from Recreation and Parks. Kyle is the co-chair. This morning we're here to present the 6th Annual Safety Matters Award. The Safety Matters Award program was initiated by the Employee Safety Committee in an effort to promote and support a safety culture in county government. The Safety Committee is comprised of representatives from each department, and those representatives are appointed by their department head. Are there any members here this morning? Would you like to stand for a moment? Great, Tyrone back there. Thank you. Commissioners, before we call up our four employees, I'd like to give a special mention to Kathy Arnold. Kathy's the county's risk manager, and as part of Kathy's responsibilities, she provides all of us leadership and expertise in safety in and out of the workplace. Her professionalism and dedication is commendable. On a weekly basis, Kathy sends out emails on safety issues to all employees. She constantly is monitoring the county equipment, that it's safe and reliable and in compliance. If an injury does occur, Kathy's very compassionate and determined in her approach, so our employees obtain the care they need and their transition back to work is successful. So thanks, Kathy. The committee has developed the criteria for the awards program, and the three basic criteria are prevents an accident or injury, contributes to safety in the workplace, and demonstrates safety leadership. So we'd like to recognize four individuals this morning. Please come forward when I call your name. This individual works down at Chancellor's Run Park, one of the most heavily used parks in the county. He sets a wonderful example for other staff, volunteers, citizens, and especially the youth of the county. Al Bailey from Recreation and Parks. Our second employee has to focus on safety in his job every day. As a driver, he keeps his passengers safe and secure. He ensures his equipment is safe, and he also has an impeccable driving record. This individual works for Public Works and Transportation as an STS bus driver, Billy Schrock. This next individual is the first person to lend a hand when lifting heavy boxes, moving, or even if assembly is required in the office. His keen eye is quick to catch minor safety issues in the workplace. He helps the office to maintain an excellent safety rating during inspections. From the finance department, Brandon Hayden. Thanks, Brandon,
thank you very much.
And our fourth employee also has safety of our citizens in his hands. He transports ADA riders and ensures they are safely secured in the bus. He is vigilant about pre-inspecting and post-inspecting his bus before turnover. Also from Department of Public Works and Transportation and an STS bus driver, Leroy Russell. We want to thank all of you for keeping safety in the forefront of your jobs every day.
One more photo op, then we'll let you get back to work.
Where's your pen? Oh, pen?
I know there's a simple reason.
Give it about a minute here to calm down. Okay, we'll go right into one of our main agenda items here, Department of Aging and Human Services. Decision following public hearing for the Community Development Block Grant Funding Three Oaks Project. Lori Jennings, how you doing?
Good morning. Morning, Commissioners. So this is a follow-up to the public hearing which was held June 14th regarding the Three Oaks CDBG project, which involves the expansion of the WARM program. Provides a Veterans Resource Center and six crisis beds at the new Three Oaks building for individuals who have challenging situations. The second public hearing provided an opportunity for the citizens of St. Mary's County to provide input on the activities of the project, and there were no comments during the public hearing. There was also a seven-day period for the county to receive written comments from the community, and as of June 21st, there were no comments. So today I'm asking for the commissioner's decision to move forward with the project.
Any questions, Commissioner?
Well, it's just a great project.
Yeah.
A really fantastic example of a public-private partnership.
I agree.
And we forward the new Three Oaks Center down there, which is a great idea. Great project.
Came together very well. I'm impressed with how quickly it came together and the services that
it'll help a lot of people
provide. Yes.
Any other questions?
Mr. President, I move to continue the support of the Three Oaks project, the modular structure, programming, and funding through fiscal year 2017 in cooperation with the Department of Housing and Community Development.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed? Ayes have it.
Thank you.
Okay, next we move right into County Administrator time. Dr. Bridget.
Thank you, Commissioner President Guy. Please note, Commissioners, there are no Commissioners meetings July 5th and July 12th. So I bring your attention to the draft meeting agendas for July 19th and the 26th. On July 19th, we begin a new item on your agenda is the approval of a consent agenda, if that's necessary for letters that go out from the Commissioners. Also, that morning you have the wrap-up of from finance for the decision on the Bay District Volunteer Fire Department loan refinancing. Also from finance is the decision on the local vendor policy repeal. Human Resources will present the decision for the Sheriff's Office Retirement Plan 10th Amendment. Also tentatively scheduled from the Office of the County Attorney is the Building Code Appeals Board creation. At 10 a.m., you have a public hearing scheduled from the Department of Public Works and Transportation to review the Cedar Lane Blacksmith Shop Road project. The following week, on July 26th, you begin your morning at 9 a.m. with a ribbon-cutting ceremony for Phase 6 of the Three-Notch Trail. You come back to the commissioners' meeting room at approximately 10:30 that morning to begin your business meeting. 10:35, you have a recognition, a commendation for an employee of the Emergency Services and Technology Department. Also a proclamation that morning for the Americans with Disabilities Act Day. Tentatively scheduled from the Office of the County Attorney is the decision land use regulations for the sign ordinance. And tentatively scheduled is the bond sale that morning as well. For this morning's business meeting, we begin with item B from Finance for the approval of the resolution authorizing issuance and sale of general obligation bonds. Jeanette Cudmore, CFO, and Cheryl Guth, Bond Counsel, presenting. Good morning, ladies.
Good morning.
Good morning,
good morning, commissioners.
We went to New York June 7th through the 8th. And we came, now we're here, asking you to approve the resolution for us to sell the bonds electronically on July 26th for $25 million.
Okay, I move to approve and execute resolution 2016-16, authorizing the issuance and sale of general obligation bonds in the amount of $25 million to fund previously approved capital projects as described in the resolution.
Second.
Those in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed?
Nay.
One nay? Ayes have.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, commissioners. And item C is also from Legal and Finance to approve the reversion of CIP PAYGO to general fund. Jeanette Cudmore presenting, and she's joined by George Sparling, county attorney. Good morning.
Good morning. Commissioners, we have in front of you a budget amendment for you to approve for $3.3 million, which is reverting CIP PAYGO to the general fund for settlement for the Marcus case.
And commissioners, I've also included in your package and asked you to authorize council to enter into a consent order in the circuit court resolving the pending litigation there.
For the public record, Mr. Sparling, would you please give everybody a Cliff Notes version of what we're doing today?
Well, what we're doing today is taking the first step in the resolution of litigation that's been going on since I think the year 2005, predating my arrival on the scene, where it was asserted that methane gas had migrated from the St. Mary's County landfill onto the adjoining property, which is now included in the First Colony development. The matter was litigated through federal court and then back into state court, where there was an assertion that migration of gas, which is a physical intrusion, is actually a condemnation of the property. And based upon the recommendations of counsel, and after considerable negotiations, number one, there was never any question, really factually, that there was the migration of gas, and under the law, there really wasn't much of a question that it can constitute a condemnation of the property. The only real question was the issue of damages. There were, in the litigation, there were appraisals of the property produced, and there were also allegations of additional damages. And the agreement that was finally reached was that, and we're asking the court to enter an order disposing of the litigation, the county will pay the sum of $7 million to the developers of First Colony, and the developers will indeed
in return, transfer to the county the affected property, which is always a recommended disposition in any kind of contamination case, that the county simply acquire the property and resolve the issues.
Thank you. And Ms. Cummins, would you please tell the public where the money is going to come from?
CIP, PAYGO, from the BRAC project.
So we have some of the money in hand, or we have all the money in hand?
Yes.
Thank you.
Any other questions, commissioners? I move to, we need a motion then, somebody?
I move to approve and authorize Commissioner President Guy to execute the budget amendment in the amount of $3,300,000, reverting CIP PAYGO to the general fund for the settlement with Marcus LLC. Two, I move to authorize counsel for the commissioners of St. Mary's County to consent to the entry in civil action 18 TAC Charlie TAC 13 TAC 000115 in the circuit court for St. Mary's County of an order approved by counsel requiring payment of $7 million to Marcus LLC and a conveyance of specified real property to the commissioners of St. Mary's County.
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed?
Nay.
No. Let's have a roll call vote. Ms. Morgan?
Aye.
Mr. O'Connor?
Nay. Aye.
No. Aye. Three ayes, no two noes. Approved.
And item D, commissioners, is also from Finance and Legal to approve a budget amendment increasing HW1001, Dr. Johnson Bridge Culvert Replacement Project. Jeanette Cudmore, CFO, and George Sparling, County Attorney, presenting.
Commissioners, we have another budget amendment for settlement of the project for Dr. Johnson Bridge Culvert Replacement for $460,847. These funds are coming from the FIN 16 Transfer Tax Reserve.
And in like matters, Commissioner, I have included a proposed settlement agreement resolving all issues between the county and the contractor. The matter is reached my office. I would advise commissioners that we've spent an aggregate of approximately 3 days negotiating these items back and forth. There were a number of items to which the contractor was indisputably really entitled to some compensation. Really the issue on most items was how much compensation and substantiation of the expenses. I'd advise the commissioners, as we're sitting here, the contractor representatives of the Department of Public Works are going over the paperwork to finalize the substantiation of these expenditures. And why that is important is there is a possibility that up to, as I understand it, up to 80% of this money may possibly be reimbursed by the State Highway Administration to the county. We feel this resolves all claims and is an appropriate settlement.
Why would they be willing to put up 80% of this?
Because the contract was 80% funded by the State Highway Administration. And if I'm getting any of this wrong, I know Mr. Erickson's sitting behind me. He can probably explain this with greater clarity. If these are all recognized legitimate overcharges that are substantiated to the satisfaction of State Highway Administration, they would become part of the contract price, as I understand it. But perhaps Mr. Erickson can clarify that.
Seems to be in agreement. He's shaking his head up and down.
Here's my question. What have we learned from this and the previous one where we just had to sell for $7 million? It would seem to be that there's something amiss or something wrong with our processes if we've now run into a situation. These people called Commissioner President Guy and myself and said, can you come out here and look at this bridge? Trying to build this bridge, we're having trouble with the county. We're having trouble with quantities, specifications, this, that, and the other. And we went out there and looked, and we're not experts, we're not engineers. But what they said made sense. And we reported that stuff back. And here we are a year later dealing with this. What have we learned from this? Are we changing anything in our processes? Are we going to continue to do the same thing we've always done?
Well, Let me say as a preface, and I will answer that question hopefully as best as I can, as a preface, after 3 days, as I say, accumulatively over the last several weeks, including all-day sessions of going over this, appearances can be deceiving. I would not reach the same conclusion or a conclusion that the contractor was right in all these matters. But I don't think it's appropriate, once the issues have been resolved, to start relitigating that particular question. Going on to your express question, yes. I would note that our process is reasonably effective. In the 6 years that I've been county attorney, this is only the second time that a construction dispute has reached my office. So I don't know how many construction projects we've had in that period of time, but probably that's a fairly good track record. But the process can always be improved. And I think the primary improvement has to come in the management of change orders. By coincidence, the county administrator and DPW department head, Luggum department head, Reckon Parks, and myself all viewed what I thought was a very impressive automated system for processing change orders in the future that would certainly that or a similar program, without the addition of more personnel, would provide a very effective means of preventing the type of confusion that he said, he said, the type of misunderstandings in some instances that arose in a project such as this. And one never says never, and no system is perfect. I often quote Warren Buffett, who says that any system that is perfect is a hobby and not a business practice. However, I think that if we are able to implement some system, as the county administrator is suggesting, I would not expect to be here again with this type of issue.
Okay. Fair enough. Thank you.
I hope we can look at the process overall from the beginning, not just the end as well. This was a contract that was awarded to somebody that had never built this type of structure before. So if I'm looking at a logical point of view and I need somebody to build an airplane, I'm going to find somebody that has experience building airplanes. So I think we ran into this situation by awarding to somebody as well that did not have, or the experience was severely lacking in that area. And I do know that the state played into this with other issues as far as old plans and various different things from MDE that overrun, and we have other factors. But from the beginning all the way through the end, it's not just the change orders. I think it's the evaluative process that we need to take a look at when we're awarding these. And that entire process from beginning to end, whether it's interviews, their resumes, completed projects, I think we would have probably been in a better position, although we can Monday night quarterback it forever. But I think from the beginning all the way through, it's something we need to take a look at.
Well, I would say, Commissioner O'Connor, I'm in full agreement with that. As a matter of fact, as we are reviewing our procurement ordinance and our procurement policies right now, my sense has been the principal objects of the procurement process are to benefit the public through both the government and the confidence the public has that contracts are fairly awarded. But within that framework, low bid is not always the best bid. And I think that additional, as you just described them, evaluative components really would benefit the county and the taxpayers. I think Ms. Cudmore.
Probably in the past, we've been constantly looking at low bid as the winner of a contract, where I think when you start looking at the qualifications, just like Commissioner O'Connor
said. Well, you know, in defense of the low bidder, I do believe it's in the public's best interest to take the low bid. Now, is it the best, is a person the most responsible, or is it a responsible low bid? And I'm hoping that what comes out of this, and it sounds like it's going to be something positive, so I'm glad of that. But I'm hoping what comes out of this is that there's a determination of these bids are responsible. We heard last week or a week or two ago from Brandon Hayden that competitiveness is one of the ingredients of being in business. Now, I've always believed that for someone to succeed, it's not that they have to know what the other bids are. They have to know what they need to do to be able to do that job, pay their help, make some money if that's what it is. So with all that said, it sounds like we are doing things to make it better going forward. The fact that you only had 2 in 6 years, that's encouraging. I'm glad to hear that. So thank you for that.
And I will chime in that having been doing this government procurement stuff for 35 years, I have found that more often than not, you get what you pay for when you go to low bid. And I can't tell how many times we watch the low bid on whatever it is, and we wait for the change orders to come in, and the profits made with the change orders, not with the original intent. And anybody that follows anything in defense knows that you go as low as you can to build a boat, a plane, a submarine, whatever, in part piece parts, and then once there's the minutest change, the price starts to skyrocket. So I would encourage that as we look at things, low bid may not always be the best intent for the public good, and simultaneously we should be looking at our procurement processes to ensure that, you know, low ball doesn't always get you what you want to at the end of the day.
I'm listening to Commissioner Hewitt's point. I also went out there, but you know, he did already mention that this was something that was brought to the attention a year ago. And I know government can be slow and deliberative, but these changes that we're speaking of, I would charge our staff, department heads, and all those involved in it that these changes are swift, calculated, and thorough. Because this is the taxpayers' money we're talking about. It should not take a year to make these changes in the evaluative process and how we're moving forward. Because in that year, we're just going to be wasting taxpayer money if this ever comes up again. Mind you, this is only the second time, but change orders and everything do cost the taxpayer money. So swift, calculated, and thorough is what I expect out of these changes, and not to be sitting here a year later discussing how we're going to change it.
Thank you.
Of course, let's hope you pursue with vigor the 80%. Then it costs us less than $100,000 in the end if we can get that money back. Any other questions, commissioners?
Move to approve and authorize Commissioner President Guy to execute the budget amendment, reducing transfer tax in the FIN 16 Capital Reserve and increasing the Dr. Johnson Bridge Culvert Replacement Project HW1001 in the amount of $460,847. Second, I move to authorize the Commissioner President to execute the settlement agreement with C.A. Bean, Inc. upon final determination by the county attorney that all preconditions to release of all claims have been satisfied.
And simply to clarify that last clause refers to the fact that, as I said, they're still meeting this morning to go over receipts that would enable us to seek reimbursement and to make sure that we have all the necessary releases of liens by subcontractors and material. Excuse me. And I would not intend to present the release to Commissioner Guy until we're sure we have all that.
Good, okay.
I'll second that.
Discussion real quick.
Discussion?
Just to clarify, because I want to make sure that the public is absolutely clear, because we're talking change orders and we're talking what we're trying to settle this morning. This isn't a change order. This is accumulation of mediation going through our pre-arbitration opportunity. So it's not like we're today, a year later, making a change order to a project. All that's been taken care of. This is literally a grievance from the contractor, a grievance from the county, and we're trying to get through mediation, and this is the settlement. So this is not a change order, just for the record.
Yeah, this actually represents the aggregate of 34 different change orders that have been discussed and negotiated.
Thank you.
And we've just, 34 different change orders, and we have decided that we are going to pay X number, I understand.
Yes.
Yeah, anything else? I have a first and a second. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed?
No.
That's 4 ayes and 1 no.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. And item E, commissioners, is the Department of Public Works and Transportation to review the FDR Boulevard resolution to accept roadway into the county's highway maintenance system and ordinance authorizing the posting of speed limit signs. Mr. Erickson, Director, DPW&T, presenting. Good morning.
Good morning, commissioners. There's an informational memorandum in your package. I think it's dated June 10th of this year. This is an administrative follow-up to prior presentation by Recreation and Parks regarding the conveyance of properties along the frontage of a new entrance to Nicollet Park. All the associated deeds have now been recorded, and the acceptance of this section of existing FDR Boulevard into the county maintenance system will provide a county owned to maintain public access to the new Nicollet Park entrance, which is currently under design. It's about 0.23 miles long, and it'll provide public access from Great Mills Road up to the park entrance.
So from the public who's not looking at a map, this is literally from Great Mills Road right up to the old movie theater?
Up to the old movie theater, where the turn in the road comes off of 235.
So if we bring this into the county, all those potholes are going to get filled?
That's correct.
That sounds good.
Correct. No, I saw in here you're looking for a 25-mile-an-hour speed limit.
Yes, sir.
In my opinion, that's too fast. Now, what you're going to be doing is going past that building that has Aaron's rental, that big building. Mm-hmm. And what you have in there is a lot of vegetation on one side and the building on the other side. Looks like you have some kind of an emergency exit, or could be any kind of an exit that kind of comes right almost on this road. Now, is there plans to, I believe 25 miles an hour is too fast. It's a private road, been a private road, and there's speed bumps on it to try and keep people's speed down.
Yes, sir.
Now, my concern is, I think there's a lot of pedestrian traffic that comes through Nicollet Park, that subdivision there, I'm sorry, Patuxent Homes, that would probably walk down through and maybe go to where that Aaron's is and those markets are and the other, you know, commercial places down there. So I think the 25 mile an hour is too fast. Why is that being recommended?
We left the three-way stop controls for the pedestrians that exist there today, so that pedestrian stop sign access will stay. We did a speed study as well. Commissioner O'Connor, the 85th percentile speed was between 20 and 26 miles an hour, so a 25 mile an hour speed is appropriate. If there is an issue with speeding, which we will follow up, we will add speed humps, not speed bumps, back into the project. And we've also coordinated this with Rochelle.
Okay, now let me understand this. I've turned off of Great Mills Road and I made a left on this road. Now I'm headed over there to Nicollet Park. And there's a lot of woods and whatnot, or just vegetation on that left side as I go down there. Now, a child or somebody just pops out of there and walks out in front. I have very limited in my sight line. I guess I can see straight. But as far as people coming out who may be used to just walking across there, not going down to the parking or the crosswalk at the three stop signs you're talking about, I still believe that's a safety issue. And that, can we do like a 15 mile an hour speed limit? Do we have some kind of rules and regulations on speed limits?
We can actually post below 25, I don't believe, but I can come back with you with an alternative recommendation. We did do the speed study and looked at the speeds of existing traffic, which is not in excess of that.
Again, what I guess I say is the speed bumps slow you down. You take those, are they going to remain? Are you going to take them out?
We were going to take those out, recheck the speed, and if speed's an issue, put speed humps in. Humps are more appropriate for a public road than the bumps.
Well, let me ask this question. Since I've been driving over that road, I think as some of the other coaches have for over 30 years, the speed humps seem to work and slow people down. So to Commissioner Hewitt's point, I agree that 25 miles an hour could be too fast. But simultaneously, with those speed humps there and, you know, like Pavlov's dog's conditioning, everybody knows to slow down when you're going down that road. Mm-hmm. I see no practical purpose to taking those speed bumps out just as a county-maintained road right now. So maybe the compromise could be keep it at 25, but leave all those speed humps in there, because I think there's three of them along the way, and they do deter speed. And as Commissioner Hewitt points out, coming down, I don't know how many people coming through that early part of the woods there by Aaron's, but I know there's two or three paths along the way, but between the three-way stop signs, the three speed humps that are there, it definitely should discourage aggressive driving back there.
So maybe he's, if I'm hearing you correctly, sir, he's saying there's a difference between the speed bumps that exist on that private road now and what a highway speed hump would be, which sounds like it's a little larger.
Right, it's a little larger. It's a lot easier for the snow removal equipment to actually remove the snow off the roadway. So, if, you know, the recommendation could be to replace the humps that are there with bumps initially, as opposed to wait for our follow-up speed study. And that's certainly something we can do.
I know how hard we've tried to get humps before, and except for a couple of places back in Wildwood, humps have not exactly been popping up all over the county.
No, but they're what we would recommend in lieu of bumps.
I think there's a couple issues with the the humps anyway. One is it slows fire and EMS response. It slows police response. Two, lowering a speed limit. I disagree with lowering the speed limit because lowering a speed limit does not necessarily gain compliance with that speed limit. So if the 85th percentile is 20 to 25 miles per hour, actually the course of practice is to match that 85th percentile reasonably.
That's great.
Because most drivers' behavior is at that location. So a vehicle traveling roughly 20 to 25 miles per hour is at 52 feet per second. It takes about 1.5 seconds to react. That's 78 feet. They'll travel by the time they stop. It's already marked. All you're going to do is actually increase people's behavior to speed because they get frustrated at the 15 miles per hour. So they're looking at it, they're like, I got to go, and then they just speed. They're always going to break the speed limit, especially if the 85th percentile is already 20 to 25. Roadway design will help with that as they build the entrance, but there was another instance that this happened where the county lowered the speed limit in the northern end of the county because they thought it would gain compliance, and all it did was actually increase the speeding issue. I think it went from 40 to 30. And now there's just people doing 40 anyway, and now they're breaking the speed limit, and 85th percentile hasn't changed.
But there's no enforcement anyways.
Yeah, the enforcement, now that it's a county road and not a private road, would turn to the sheriff's office and the state police to enforce once it's conveyed over to the county. So enforcement, there's other means to slow people down. They have the VSA boards, the speed trailers if necessary. And ultimately, if it is found that people are speeding in excess of that, then yes, maybe the speed hump may be something that we need to do there, or pedestrian crossing with the sign in the middle where it's a crosswalk and you have the sign where you stop. But the two things I'm concerned about is emergency vehicle response into Nicollet Park when it's done and FDR in itself, and then two, lowering the speed limit does not necessarily gain compliance.
So I think that for me, I mean, I travel that road every day because my office is right around the corner. The threat is not from pedestrians walking across the road. The threat is from kids on bicycles popping out of the, which happens frequently. I
mean, they might be walking.
So I guess the question I would have is how much easement do we have to the north of the road is once we take this? Because there is several dirt trails that come down. And again, it's not pedestrians walking across. It's the kids zipping down on bicycles.
The north of the road, is that the Patuxent Homes side?
Yeah. Okay.
Do we need to put a fence line?
Yeah, exactly.
Maybe a fence line.
If we're going to be putting in a great entrance that's going to be paved, kids will most likely be riding their bike down the paved thing, I would hope. But to Commissioner Hewitt's point as well, people get used to using these trails that have cut through.
I think we should look at behind that building. There should be a fence line put up the entire woods.
Well, here's the thing. I mean, not you got enough questions on you already, but what about sidewalks? You know, my sense is you're going to have people walking down there. I mean, Lexington Park has a lot of pedestrian traffic. Now, I've driven that road like everybody else has.
We got to stop them from going through the woods.
Well, no. Hey, look, going through the woods has been some. I mean,
I did a lot of woods traveling.
Yeah, right. We all have. My point is, though, is if I've seen people walking up and down that road while I've been driving it, and they're very sensitive to a car coming because they don't have much room. So do you have plans for sidewalks? I mean, what else is going on in there?
The upgrade of this roadway was discussed on several occasions on what would be needed to upgrade this roadway, and these were all items discussed during the process of the transaction process. So it's all on what it is that we're willing to do with this section of FDR Boulevard. It's not in the capital improvement budget. There are no additional monies to upgrade the roadway. The understanding was that the land swap would be provided so that we would have a public access to Nicollet Park. Nicollet Park is then going to design its entrance, and with the entrance design, if there are any other upgrades to FDR that we want to bring forward, we can bring that forward with the CIP process. But certainly, it's in a commercial area. You could put curb and gutter, closed storm drain system, sidewalks. There's a lot of things you could do with that roadway.
But would we have to acquire property to do it?
We should have enough right-of-way, but we didn't get a lot of right-of-way. But we do have right-of-way.
I mean, here's my thought. If you're on Great Mills Road and you want to walk over to Nicollet Park and you don't feel like going up through Patuxent Homes, I'm going to walk down the new FDR Boulevard. And what do I get to protect me from the traffic? Do I have a sidewalk or do I not have a sidewalk?
You don't have a sidewalk.
Okay.
And bigger picture, this portion of FDR Boulevard is going to be encompassed into the total FDR Boulevard project, correct?
No, sir.
No, okay. I just want to make sure.
Well, there's nothing above it between
where you're talking about the I hate to use the term, the old movie theater.
Right.
But the movie theater in Lexington Park.
That's correct.
And Peg Road.
That's correct.
So all this is to get access out to Great Mills Road.
Yeah, the purpose of the transaction was just to get access to record the deeds and then accept it into the county maintenance system. Once we accept it into the system, then decide what it is that we want to do with it.
So I think that's the key.
Well, is there still access from the other way, though?
Yes, it's private. From 235.
So it'll be like the way it's been for the last 40 years, 50 years.
Just for that corner.
Nothing about what you see today on that road will have changed at all with the recommendation, with the exception of the speed humps we were going to take out.
And the speed limit going to 25. I've never seen a speed limit.
Well, posting is there's no speed
limit. It's just posted.
It's private road.
And again, to Commissioner O'Connor's question, the purpose of looking at the 85th percentile speed is that is how people drive today.
With speed bumps. Take them out, they're going to
with
drive
speed bumps.
Slower.
Well, the average speed there is only between 18 and 21, so it's not at the higher end. It still is at the lower end.
So I think speed bumps are attributed to that.
Well, one of the other issues to look at is safety through design, because we're talking about speed on this little portion. But if you look at the entire three-notch trail, we have crossings on 5 that's 50 miles per hour. And you go up further, and we have another one that's 50 miles per hour. And all we did was put the crosswalk in and design it with the safety lights, and there's more than enough room for people to negotiate on the side of the roads. So this one location being that you give me a speed, the average of 18 to 21 and an 85th percentile of 20 to 25, I feel pretty comfortable knowing that I have 250 mile per hour ones that have safety mechanisms in place. We wish the speed limit could be lower, but obviously we're not going to put speed bumps on that road, and we're not going to do anything else. We're going to put the proper safety equipment in place. I know that lower speed limits encourage speeding, so I wouldn't mess with what's already established in people's behavior.
But our recommendation for improvements to the road is something we can bring back. This wasn't today's exercise.
To point.
But the input, getting the input early is a lot better, because when we bring something back,
right,
we have
exactly.
Feedback.
Become an additional CIP project to do the improvements that we all want here.
Oh, absolutely.
Sidewalks, things like that.
Absolutely.
As of right now, the Millicents would have to do that because we haven't accepted the property. So he's asking for us to accept the property, and then we can have all these.
Well, the property's been accepted and the deeds have been recorded, so we do have it.
Right.
Period. Today.
Right.
So today is just the formal acceptance. And the posting of speed limit signs, and then we'll come back to you with our recommendation.
We're giving you approval to accept it into the highway system for the county, and as well as setting speed limit.
And if we want to maintain the humps, you know, that direction as opposed to remove them.
Because we have the snow removal, and it's a problem right now with the present speed bumps.
And we will replace them with humps. So it's not that there won't be a device there.
There's significant damage to that roadway because of poor repair over the years. So I would say you need to fix the road first and then put the humps back in it versus trying to work around the existing.
We have raised the lack of maintenance on this roadway many times, and it's been well understood that we would be accepting that burden. So comments are noted and understood.
It was a private roadway until we now took possession of it. Understand.
That's correct.
Any other questions, commissioners?
No. Move to adopt the resolution to accept FDR Boulevard into the St. Mary's County Highway Maintenance System, and also move to adopt the ordinance setting the maximum speed.
Second. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed? Ayes have it.
Thank you,
Mr. Harrison.
And item F, commissioners, is from the Department of Economic Development to review the FY17 Memorandum of Agreement with College of Southern Maryland for the Small Business Development Center Services. Presenting is Chris Casalimas, Director, Economic Development, and Ellen Flowers Field, the Director of the Southern Maryland Small Business Development Center.
Good morning.
Good morning. Excuse me. Today we're asking the board to approve a memorandum of agreement between the county and the College of Southern Maryland to continue the services of the Small Business Development Center. The SBDC works to help startups and small businesses get going in St. Mary's County. The commissioners have allocated $37,500 for this MOA in the fiscal year 17 budget. SBDC has provided services to the county since 1980. SBDC is funded by the U.S. Small Business Administration, and a requirement of this funding is that the local government must provide a cash match to defray program costs. This is an annual agreement and the 10th that the county has entered into with the college for the services of the SBDC. The SBDC is conveniently located on the floor that my office is in the Potomac building. That's very handy because we refer people back and forth. And with that, I think Ellen has a few comments.
Yes. Thank you very much. Good morning. We very much appreciate the support of the Board of County Commissioners over the past 10 years, particularly the support for level funding again this year. And the co-location with the Economic Development Office in St. Mary's County is pivotal to our ability to really reach the businesses within the area and understand their needs. It also helps us to be strategic and targeted towards the industry initiatives that the Economic Development Office has. Over the past fiscal year, we served 158 small and emerging businesses in the region. And we're seeing an increasing trend of those businesses that are gaining revenues and sales and their ability to obtain loans and invest equity within their businesses. Almost $1 million of investments were made in fiscal year FY15, and we're on track for 16 to have close to $1 million as well. Because of your contribution and your support over the years, you know, the federal funding has been very flat. Sometimes we've lost funding. But because of your support, we've been able to increase outreach and offer additional workshops for small businesses who've received, 118 small businesses have received technical support through our trainings here in St. Mary's County. That has allowed us to generate program income that I didn't even have a chance to share with you, Chris, that will allow us in FY17 to make our position in St. Mary's County full-time. It's been a part-time position for years. At 30 hours a week, I think most recently, it had slowly rose up from 15 to 19 to 30 hours a week, and we're going to be making it a 40-hour-a-week position and really be able to provide the type of impact and services that I know we're going to need as we stand up an incubator in the county and move towards helping the high-growth manufacturing sector.
Tell me, somebody wants to assume an existing business. They've been a great worker, been a great employee, but they're not sure about management. They're not sure about cash flow. These are the kind of people you can help?
Definitely. Those are the type of people that we help every day.
Because I'm going through something right now that has somebody involved in this, and I don't mean to be personal, but I'll say this. What people need to understand is when you're running a business, there's a lot of days when you don't make money. And you hope there's days, the more days that you do than days that you don't. It's just called the cycle of being in business. Yeah. And sometimes people understand that it's, you know, easy to have more help, hire more people, but they don't understand that costs more money. So if that's something, how do people get in touch with you?
Well, entrepreneurial education is pivotal to the work that we do, and very, very often people, you know, they see a business and they see people coming in and out of it, and they think, gosh, that business is making money. It must be successful. I can just start a business as well. So educating them on the ups and downs. But individuals can reach us by certainly visiting us here in the Economic Development Office on our website, which is somdhelp.com. Individuals can visit us there. And then our phone number here in the county, we're calling the Economic Development Office. It's a direct line to us.
Do you have that number?
Off the top 01-475
something or another?
It's not off the top of my head. I don't have it.
Okay. Well, maybe you can provide it sometime.
We get calls very often for people saying, I want to start a business or have an idea for a business. And if they're at that stage, especially, we refer them to the SBDC because they do classes on how to do a business plan, how to get going. There's a variety of classes. Many of them are taught right here at the Leonardtown campus of CSM. Very convenient. If somebody is just kind of has an idea or maybe has, done just a little bit of work, we're looking for some specific instruction and some advice, SBDC is a big help.
So is there a relationship still with PTAP?
Yes. The Procurement and Technical Assistance Coordinator, Mary Lee Kolick, who I believe serves this region forever, is still around. And she has itinerant scheduling St. Mary's County when she comes over. And she has an office in Charles County as well.
Great.
Now, PTAP, Property Tax Appeals Board?
No.
The Procurement and Technical Assistance Program, it's funded by the Department of Defense, and their focus is strictly to provide counseling and support to businesses that are looking to do business with the government, both local, state, and federal government.
It's a big difference.
Sounds like
so
it.
When you start, you have, I, you, 14, 15 years ago when I started TSA. I worked with Mary Lee, so she's been doing it for a long time. Mm-hmm. And, yeah, it's a totally different approach to doing business when you're playing with federal government versus retail.
Yes.
So good. I'm glad to hear that connection's still there.
Any other questions?
I move to approve the memorandum of agreement between the county and the College of Southern Maryland on behalf of the Department of Economic Development for the Small Business Development Center services in the amount of $37,500, which is consistent with the fiscal year 2017 approved budget, and authorize the Commissioner President to execute the related document.
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed? Ayes have it. Thank you all.
Thank you.
Thank you, Commissioners. Item G is from the Department of Aging and Human Services to present the FY 2017 BHA Substance-Related Disorders and Prevention Services Grant Subrecipient Agreements. Presenting is Lori Jennings Harris, Director, Department of Aging and Human Services, and Mary Ellen Kreese, Treatment and Prevention Coordinator. Good morning.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Good morning, ladies and gentlemen.
Good morning again. Mm-hmm. Commissioners, in May, I believe it was May 24th, we came before you with the budgets and the MOUs between the county and DHMH, the Department of Health and Mental Hygiene, for the behavioral health funding, which would be substance abuse treatment and prevention funds for FY17, in the amount of $3,262,346. So today we are presenting the related subrecipient agreements with a number of vendors for your approval.
A lot of money. Now, this is the type of stuff that if we transition, when we transition over to the health department, this will flow through them.
Yes, exactly.
I still believe we're just a pass-through for this kind of stuff, right?
We are a pass-through for most of the money. We do some direct services. Ms. Kreese is the treatment and prevention coordinator. So she coordinates all the treatment and prevention that comes through the county to the various providers. But she also provides direct prevention services in the county as well.
I guess where I'm going with this, bang for the buck. Who's overlooking these $3,262,346? Who oversees that?
St. Mary's County Government. My staff, Ms. Kreese, the division manager, Cynthia Brown.
And when the change happens, that'll move to state?
That will move to the health department.
Okay, that's what I'm trying to.
Any other questions, commissioners? Entertain a motion.
I move to approve the fiscal year 2017 BHA Substance-Related Disorders and Prevention Services Grant Subrecipient Agreements, 8 in total, between the county and Walden Sierra Incorporated, St. Mary's Hospital of St. Mary's County, Inc., doing business as MedStar St. Mary's Hospital, and the Jude House, Inc., in the total amount $3,262,346, to provide substance abuse treatment and prevention services to the residents of St. Mary's County, and authorize the Commissioner President to execute the related documents.
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed? Ayes have it. Thank you, ladies.
Thank you. Thank you, Commissioners. And item H is also from the Department of Aging and Human Services to present the FY 2016 4th Revised State Grant. Joining Ms. Jennings Harris at the table is Peggy Mayo, Fiscal Supervisor. Good morning.
Good morning. As Dr. Bridget just mentioned, this is the 4th revision notification grant award from the Maryland Department of Aging, and these funds will be used for the home-delivered meals program, the congregate meals program, and a little bit, I think, in the amount of $141 for Maryland Access Point Information and Assistance Funds. So we're just requesting your approval for the additional money.
Move to approve the FY 2016 Revised Notification of Grant Award Project MD 1601, 1602, 1604, 1605, and 1614 from the Maryland Department of Aging on behalf of the St. Mary's County Department of Aging and Human Services for programs and services for the seniors of St. Mary's County in the amount of $93,434, and the related budget amendments, which includes increasing the grant funds by $9,416, and authorize the Commissioner President to execute the related documents.
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Any opposed? Ayes have it.
Thank you.
Thank you, ladies.
Thank you, Commissioners. And item I is to appoint boards, committees, and commissions. The first motion is to appoint the following persons to boards, committees, and commissions with terms to expire as indicated. Agriculture, Seafood, and Forestry Board, Michael Cirque, June 30th, 2021. Joseph Wood, June 30th, 2021. Agriculture, Seafood, and Forestry Board to correct term expiration dates for Scott Bacon, 12/31/20. John Parlett, 12/31/19, and Charles Webb, 12/31/19. Agriculture Preservation Advisory Board, Phil Langley, Patrick Russell, David Pol- oh, I'm sorry, Phil Langley, 12/31/20, Patrick Russell, June 30th, 2019, David Polk, 12/31/19, John Shinsky, 12/31/18, Stephen Reeves, 12/31/20. Agriculture Reconciliation Committee, Colleen Corrigan, 12/31/19, Phil Dorsey, 12/31/18, David Polk, 12/31/19, John Shinsky, 12/31/18, Michael Cirque, June 30, 2021. Adult Public Guardianship Review Board, Sherry Pierce, Unlimited. Compensation Review Board, Valerie Broski, 12/1/16. Bernadette Shannon, 12/1/16. Joseph Russell, 12/1/16. Economic Development Commission, Phil Dorsey, reappointment at 6/30/19. Tom Watts, reappointment 6/30/19. Elms Advisory Committee, Charles Cameron, 6/30/21. Ethics Commission, Joseph Russell, 6/30/19. Jean Marie Hansen, alternative member, 6/30/19. And the Hazard Mitigation Plan Committee has unlimited terms for Gerald Gardner, Jr., Public Safety, Robert Kelly, County Government, Vince Whittles, Local Business, Tony Wheatley, Town of Leonardtown, William Hunt, Lugham, George Erickson, DPW&T, Michael Wyatt, Public Schools, Michael Sullivan, Metcom, and Mark Stancliffe, Technology. Sheriff's Office Retirement Plan Board, Dr. Tracy Harris, reappointment, June 30, 2019. Social Services Board, Wanda Brown, reappointment, June 30, 2019. Richard Buckler, reappointment, June 30, 2016. And Tri-County Animal Shelter, Sally Brown, 6/30/20.
So moved.
Second.
Quick question, is everybody's paperwork in order then?
Yes, sir.
Thank you.
You said Richard Buckner, 6/30/16?
19. Sorry.
Okay. Mm-hmm. So we have a motion?
Second. Motion. By Commissioner Hewitt.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? Ayes have it.
And motion number two, Commissioners, is to appoint the following persons to boards, committees, or commissions with the terms to expire as indicated. Metropolitan Commission, John Carey, 6/30/19. Alice Gaskin, reappointment, 6/30/19.
So moved.
Second.
Discussion. When I requested this to be made in two motions, but it's not, so... on the discussion, I think that I just want the public to know that I think Alice Gaskin is not the best choice for this appointment to Metcom. As this board, we have a responsibility to the ratepayer. As a business owner, if I have somebody that fails to have proper attendance at work, fails to submit their payroll or any other documents that are required, that person's fired. In this situation, Ms. Gaskin has failed to file her ethics disclosure for 3 years straight, only after prompting multiple times by not only county commissioners, the county administrator, emails, letter, Scott Bundy from Metcom, other Metcom board members, did she finally, at the 25th hour, submit her ethics disclosure. Her attendance rate is lackluster at best. I think a reappointment for Ms. Gaskin is sending the wrong message to the ratepayers of Metcom. I think it's for the wrong reasons, and that there should be somebody else that has been more responsible for 3 years. Past performance is an indicator of future performance, and in this situation, Ms. Gaskin has not performed to the level that at least I personally would expect from anybody that's sitting on a board that's representative of the ratepayers of Metcom and the commissioners of St. Mary's County. There's other qualified individuals that could have been sought after, but
here we are reappointing somebody that failed to follow the law in St. Mary's County with the Ethics Commission. So, yeah, they failed to follow county code, but yet we're going to brush that under and say it's okay, no big deal. We'll keep you on a board that sets rates and controls the MetCom for the entire county. So since this isn't, there's no separate motion, unfortunately, I'll have to vote no. But I do support the appointment of John Carey to this board, so I don't want my no vote to sway the fact that I support Mr. Carey be appointed there, and I have full faith that he'll do a good job.
So we did do some research on this, and just for the public's record, Ms. Gaskin is not the only person who had failed to put in a financial disclosure report. Several people have done that. We asked as part of this that we wouldn't reappoint anyone who didn't clean up the paperwork, and Dr. Bridget, you took care of that and made sure that people did file the correct paperwork. Also, if you don't mind, I don't like to read people's emails, but we asked very pointedly the question on attendance from Ms. Gaskin, and the response we got back from MetCom was that she had completed a financial disclosure statement. Her attendance rate was 68% for the last 12 months, and more recently, from January to April 2016, her attendance is 88%, or 7 of the 8 meetings posted in their meeting minutes. So there was a very big concern that perhaps she wasn't attending the meetings, but I think that concern has been alleviated.
And to address that, I mean, I recommend that anybody that didn't file a financial disclosure prior to our last meeting not be reappointed. However, the process was changed to accommodate Ms. Gaskin.
And so, others.
And others. She went
and others that did not have their financial disclosure in only after I recommended that the...
They finally filed them all, then.
Yeah, they finally filed them all, but we changed the entire process to accommodate her.
Now, I directed Dr. Bridget to send letters to them, emails, that if they didn't have it by Monday, they would be disqualified.
Of course.
They met that.
So. No, I agree with that. I understand that.
You know, it's very important that when people volunteer for a board, they know they have to show up. They know they have to be ready. But it's also very important that the boards that we appoint are reflective of the population that lives in St. Mary's County. We have to be sensitive to making sure everybody feels represented. And we do not have enough women. We do not have enough minorities. I'm not saying that has to be something we have to do. But it's important to me that when people look at these boards, they say it looks like our community. Because if we don't, I think we're doing a disservice. So I totally believe if you're appointed, you better show up. Some of you are paid. I personally believe if you don't show up, you don't get paid. But on the other hand, we need to be sensitive to what our community looks like and make our boards reflective of that.
And this is a volunteer service for the commissioners. We depend on these boards to help us. We can't be everywhere all the time. And it's very important. I will say I served 5.5 years on the Board of Appeals. What a great opportunity to help the people. We were helping the people out. And that's the big thing about these boards. We're helping our fellow citizens. It's important that you volunteer and plus you learn something about what's going on in the government. It's really good to be involved. And I encourage people to volunteer. It is all volunteer, and we do our best to make sure that everybody is qualified. We have to look at resumes, and we try to put people into the right position where they have some knowledge of what they're getting ready to make decisions on. So it's very important. For example, the Board of Appeals, you should have some idea about construction and zoning permits and things like that. So these, and any of these, you should be have some kind of a general knowledge. But we'll help you out with learning. We do have classes coming up here. What date is our next training session? July 21st for new board members. And I encourage you to come, even if you're not appointed yet, to get some idea about what you're getting ready to get yourself into and going through. And it's very rewarding to help people. And that's what this is all about, helping people. And plus, you're helping the commissioners in making decisions on guiding these various departments and various subjects. So please, we encourage you to do that. Okay. Getting back to the Metropolitan Commission, we have a motion and a second. All those in favor appointing these two?
Aye.
Aye. Opposed?
Nay.
Four ayes and one nay.
And motion three, commissioners, is to recommend the following persons to the governor's office for the indicated vacancies: Maryland Agriculture Preservation Advisory Board, Board of Trustees, Joe Wood, and Property Tax Assessment Appeal Board, Kenneth Robeson, Jr.
So moved.
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed? Ayes have it.
And this completes county administrator time.
So next we're going into public hearings?
Yep.
Okay, we're a little behind. Let's take about a 3 minute break.
3 minutes.
3 minutes. That's all you get. So run quickly. ready to restart. We're not going into some of our public hearings this morning. The first one is the Bay District Volunteer Fire Department loan refinancing. And Mr. Cudmore, we're going to turn it over to you to let's see, for purpose to start here. Sign in sheets were provided in the back, and we also have up front here. If you wish to speak with, please have you sign up. And so we'll now have our presentation from Ms. Cudmore.
Thank you. You gave authorization on June 7th for this public hearing to go forward. It was advertised in June 10th and also on June 17th for Bay District Volunteer Fire Department to enter into a refinancing consolidation loan with the Community Bank of Chesapeake for a term not to exceed 25 years at the fixed rate of 2.7% for the maximum principal of $6,313,000. So we will hold the day of the public hearing. We'll come back on July 19th for the decision.
Okay. Any questions from Ms. Cudmore? Anybody here? Okay. We will now open the hearing for public comment. We had one individual sign up, Mr. Keith Fairfax.
Thank you, Mr. President. I'm here to support that initiative. Of course, it's a reduction. We had options of 20, 25, and 30, and we picked the 25 mainly because we have pending probably about a $300,000 bill to upgrade all our breathing apparatus to meet the current standards. So we could have gone to 20, but we said, well, let's stay at 25, and we'll take the difference, and we'll bank that for this procurement of our self-contained breathing apparatus. So a little rationale there why we went from 20 to 25 to come off of 30. Turns out we'll have the loan paid off in 2041, which is about the same time we would have had the PNC loan paid off. However, the other loans would have gone to 46. So this is, I think, good business, and I'm glad we were a community bank step forward, and we were able to do this and with your support. Okay? That's all I have, Mr. President.
Thank you, sir. Does we have anyone else signed up? Do we have anyone else like to speak about this? So at this point, we'll go ahead and Commissioner St. Mary's County will receive public comments on this matter for an additional 7 days. Comments should be mailed to the Commissioners of St. Mary's County, Post Office Box 653, Leonardtown, Maryland 20650, or emailed to csmc@stmarysmaryland.com. We will now close the public hearing.
Thank you, Commissioners. Thank you.
Mr. Fairfax, thank you for all you do for the fire department and all you do in the community, sir.
I'm kind of like Dr. Roach. You got to give it back.
Yes, you are.
There you go.
Thank you very much. Give it back as long as you can.
We thank you.
You guys are two peas in a pod.
Take care.
Thanks, Keith.
Okay, next we have a public hearing for local vendor preference repeal, and Ms. Cudmore is once again in charge of that. We will now open the public hearing proposal, and sign-in sheets were provided up front. If you have not signed in, if you wish to speak, we ask that you sign in now. We will now have a presentation from Brandon Hayden and Ms. Cudmore.
All right. I'll go ahead and go and give you a break. Authorization was given also for this public hearing on June 7th, and it was advertised in the June 10th and 17th edition of the Enterprise. This is to conduct a public hearing for the repeal of the local vendor preference, resolution 2012-25.
Any questions, Commissioner?
No, just a statement. I think the authors of this initial vendor preference had all the good intentions in heart. And it made sense at the time to try it. But clearly over the performance and its longevity, it really hasn't had an impact on anything. And my biggest concern is, if we're so local as we focus on St. Mary's County, we may be hurting and doing a disservice to our local counties to do business in Charles and Calvert County who may enact a similar type of preference. So I think we tried it. It really didn't have a huge impact, and I'm afraid it could have negative repercussions. So I'm in support of the real people today.
And I would say I did support this last time. I do still feel that there should be something in our, whether it be a cost or a rating factor to help some of our local businesses, because I can't worry about Calvert or Charles right now. I have to worry about St. Mary's. So my 2 cents worth of, there's still something here that should be advantageous to our local small businesses.
I still believe lowest responsible bidder is the best for the county. But secondly, I think if you have a tie, it should go to the county. So.
Any other questions?
No, just to point out to the public, we're not making a decision. This is a public hearing day.
The decision.
So you've heard the commissioners speak, so you have 7 days to respond to the newspapers about what you think about that.
Well, maybe we got some public speakers.
You can speak out anytime you want to about this.
And we'll be back on the 19th for your decision.
Do you have public speakers?
We have, now I open it up to the public for comments. Are we all finished, commissioners? You all finished? Okay. I will now open up to the public for comment. We ask you to march to 3 minutes. The first speaker is, no one signed up.
What?
Is there anyone out there who would like to speak on this subject? Sir, please step forward.
How would you like me to come up? Or I just had a question.
Right this seat right here. Come right up here to seat here. And,
Morning. My name is Nick Motes. And I was just looking for a little clarification or explanation on what it is. That's basically it.
Okay, Brandon.
The local vendor preference allows local vendors to bid 10% higher than non-local companies and still be determined to be the low bidder. It also provides 5 additional technical points on RFPs if their cost proposals are within that 10% margin. So basically it's 10% to local businesses.
Okay, thank you.
Is there anyone else like to speak at this time? Well, then I close it for any further public hearing. The commissioners of St. Mary's County will receive public comments on this matter for an additional 7 days. The commissioner of St. Mary's County can mail to us at Post Office Box 653, Leonardtown, Maryland, 20650, or email to csmc@stmarysmaryland.com. We will now close the public hearing for public comments and close this public hearing. Thank you all.
Thank you very much.
Okay, next we have a public hearing on the Sheriff's Office Retirement Plan 10th Amendment. I think Ms. Pratt is going to address us on this. We will now open the public hearing for the proposed Sheriff's Office Retirement Plan 10th Amendment. Signing sheets were provided up front. If you have not signed in, you may wish to speak. You can go and sign in right now. We will now have a presentation from Catherine and
Karen Gates.
Oh, Karen Gates. Okay. Karen.
Benefit coordinator good. For the
I'm
plan.
Sorry. Yeah. Good.
Good morning, commissioners. On June 7th, you authorized this public hearing to consider amending the Sheriff's Office Retirement Plan with the proposed 10th Amendment. The public hearing was advertised on June 10th and on June 17th. And we are proposing that you vote on this amendment on July 19th and make a final decision. The 10th Amendment, as proposed, would remove the cap on sick leave that is used when calculating a retiree's benefit, monthly benefit. It does not accelerate the years to retirement, but the amount of sick leave is incorporated in the monthly benefit calculation. The proposed amendment would not be retroactive. We've heard from some plan members and there was confusion about the language. So for their benefit, I wanted to clarify that. The proposed effective date is August 1st, 2016. And if anyone had retired before that, they would not be, the benefit calculation would not be revised.
And this brings it in line with the rest of the county federal agencies as far as their retirement systems?
Yes, we did a poll, and Calvert County has no cap on their sheriff's office plan. It's similar to civil service as well. The state pension still has a cap for state retirees. Charles County calculates their cap differently, and Prince George's County has a cap at 26 months. So the survey we did, the counties were all over the place. But it is in line
ours
with
would be
civil
more or less
service.
Unlimited mm-hmm. as far as correct. Sick leave.
You know, the Maryland State Retirement Plan, though, when it looks at sick leave capped at 15 days for each year of service. Yes. So let's say, okay, someone's got 30 years, what, they got 450 days? Is mm-hmm. that
mm-hmm. If they didn't take sick leave.
And that seems, I guess my point is, it sounds pretty generous.
But we're going that same direction.
That's how our plan is currently written, and the proposed amendment would eliminate that 15-day cap.
I guess my point is someone could actually get up to, 2 years of sick leave if they were in great health for the whole time they were there?
They could possibly, yes.
Yes.
They could possibly do that, but they have to stay in for 30-some years, right?
And our actuary, that was one of the reasons the actuary estimated that there is no cost impact. Currently, there are no plan members that would exceed what the 15 days times 30 years would be.
Right. Very good. Okay.
Why are we why is this going to be retro to 16? Why isn't starting moving forward from a date?
It is not retroactive.
It's not retroactive. August 1st.
Oh, I'm sorry. I'm thinking FY. Sorry. No. I was in fiscal year when you said that. No.
The estimated effective date is August 1st, and it would not be retroactive.
Any other questions, commissioners?
Oh, and just we have some board members from the Sheriff's Office Retirement Board present today. Board Chair Dr. Rebecca Bridget, CFO Jennifer Cudmore, and Lieutenant Evans.
Okay. There's no other questions. We will now open the hearing for public comment. We ask that you keep remarks to 3 minutes. The first speaker is another blank sheet. Excuse me. No sign-ins. So I'll open it up to the public that's sitting there. If anybody wishes to get up and speak on this matter, please do so now. Okay. In that case, the Commissioner of St. Mary's County will receive public comments on this matter for an additional 7 days. Comments should be mailed to the Commissioner of St. Mary's County at Post Office Box 653, Leonardtown, Maryland, 20650. Email to csmc@stmarysmaryland.com. We will now close public hearing for public comments and close this public hearing. Thank you all very much.
Thank you.
And now we will go right into commissioner's time. I'm sorry, I'm 7 minutes late. Commissioner Hewitt, you can now start.
Oh, okay. Thank you, Commissioner President Guy. This past weekend was a great weekend. My granddaughter, Maddie Rose, had her 4-year-old birthday party. And what I wanted to give a shout out to is the people at the Gymnastics Center down on Lexington Park, our Recs and Parks Department. 9 super high-energy children showed up down there. And they had a wonderful time tumbling and running and playing on all the stuff down there at the gymnastics center. I was surprised and I was very happy that the county allows the people to use that or to rent it for these kind of parties. The parents are very happy. When the kids were done, they went home and they took naps. So it had its usual share of ice cream and cake, which, of course, kids have to have, that sugar. But they were able to burn it off in a positive way. And at the end of the day, it was a good experience for everybody. Happy birthday, Maddie Rose. Thank you.
So I'd just like, again, to congratulate Dr. Roach on his retirement. It's been said before, but he truly is an icon of St. Mary's County. Growing up here as son of a physician who was worked with him regularly, you know, as a kid, the county has changed so much in the last 47 years that I've been here. It's quite amazing that we used to have a sheet on our wall or right next to the kitchen sink at home on who was on duty, and there was only 3 doctors and 2 surgeons in St. Mary's County at the time. And so on the weekends, they rotate through, and they literally spend all weekend on call taking turns to go to St. Mary's Hospital, which is now where the nursing home is. So the county has changed incredibly. And to Dr. Roach's point, though we've changed, the character still remains. And I would just like, again, to congratulate a man for a fantastic career in giving so much to the community. Dr. Roach, hats off to you. One last request before you retire. Please take Commissioner Hewitt duck hunting. There's no clue how difficult it is to shoot a duck.
I just don't understand why these guys get a blast. I mean, I live on the water, and duck hunting, first thing in the morning, it's like 6:15, bam, 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 bam. I mean, they must be killing millions of ducks.
Please, Dr. Roach, take him duck hunting. So
please,
we'll
take
this
duck
argument.
It can't be that hard to hit.
Okay.
You'll see.
Make sure you put the plug in your gun. Yeah. Thank you.
Okay. John, you got
I'm
it.
I'm sure Randy's come back empty-handed plenty of
yes,
times
I have,
with
I
hundreds
have.
Of rounds expended. I just want to say congratulations to Barbara Sue Nelson, the 7th District Volunteer Fire Department, NEMS, on her appointment to the Ladies Auxiliary President for the Maryland State Firemen's Association Ladies Auxiliary. I had a chance to go out there and present her with a commendation from the Board of Commissioners and as well from the citizens of St. Mary's County. She's very dedicated to the community, and if you don't know her, you've probably seen her anyway. She's everywhere. It doesn't matter what's going on. And I told her that when I was there, is that I feel like either I'm following her around or she's following me around, because I see her at every single place I ever go. And, you know, God bless Speedy, because now he's going to have to deal with his wife traveling throughout the entire state and not just St. Mary's County. So more power to you. And I guess after a year, you'll get her back. And, well, that's all I got.
I also want to follow up on Commissioner Jarvo to Dr. Roach and also to Faith for, you know, their tireless service to the community. And I told Dr. Roach, I wasn't sure what I was going to say, but I think as Commissioner Hewitt said, there's been many a day that he and a few of the other ALS and emergency service people have sat down at a table and counseled me with their fingers to, you have to understand, and I'm really starting to figure it out. It's only taken 6 years, but I'm just a little bit slow. So again, to Dr. Roach and Faith, thank you very much for all you've done. This past week, I had the opportunity to attend the Tri-County Council quarterly dinner. Secretary Barkenfelder was there from Ag, and he gave a good presentation on where he saw Ag going in the state. It is progressing and is looking good, so kudos there. Saturday was the historic St. Mary's City Beer Fest. I sat for 6 hours and took tickets. I will sit there and say we had a lot of new people. Thousands of people came down. A really, really good event for everybody. And then yesterday I went up and participated in the nine innings of networking. And that is an annual presentation put on by the job seekers around the Tri-County region. We had over 40 to 45 companies interview and taking resumes. I think we had over 1,000 people come to participate and are looking for jobs. So again, as we have been trying to push at this table, jobs are a very important issue for us. And we're trying to work as a region here to promote more jobs and more economic development. That just gives you an example of what the supply and demand was yesterday up at the Blue Crab Stadium. And with that, that's pretty much all I got. So thank you very much.
Very good, Brent. Thank you, Commissioners, for everything you've done this past week. Really, to qualify something, what you heard today was some land litigation and contract litigation we had to go through. These are things that go through for many, many years. And this decision took a long time to come about. And I know it sounds like a lot of money spent, and unfortunately it happened even before our watch, for most of us here, all of us here in this commission. And I'll let you know that this was not, the motion you heard today was the final motion. It's been discussed. It's been in and out of courts and everything else. And we do everything to do to get, I should say, spend as little as possible to make these litigations happen. So we've done everything we can as commissioners to reduce it down to this amount. And without taking it further, we could have gone to court further, but it probably would have cost us more. So I just want to tell you that we've done everything to do to take care of this. I want to remind everybody that this coming weekend, of course, is a big celebration for most of this country, the 4th of July. It's a huge celebration for one of the greatest countries in the world. I say enjoy. We have many things going on in the county. First Friday in Leonardtown, concert series down at St. Mary's City, fireworks all over. I say have a good time, but please, please be very responsible, especially for those of you who are driving vehicles with your loved ones in there. Do not drink and drive. With that said, we close this meeting.